Welcome back. A third presidential debate in the books. And the question is, did it change anything? Bill Carrick is a highly regarded political consultant, having worked for scores of Democratic candidates on the national level, navigating most recently the re-election of Dianne Feinstein to the U.S. Senate. Mike Murphy has done the same for the Grand Old Party. Candidates from Mitt Romney to John McCain. He's also with the USC Center for the Political Future and a part of a really superb political podcast. We don't often pitch those. Hacks on Tap, which he conducts with former Obama advisor David Axelrod, a truly inside baseball look at politics. You can find it wherever you find podcasts. It really is.
Well, thank you. I appreciate
it. Superb.
We're having a lot of fun. You know, Ax and I are personal friends beyond politics. We've been for 30 years, so we've had these phone conversations forever, even when we were running campaigns against each other in some governor's race about what's really going on. And he had the great idea, let's turn this thing into a podcast. So Hacks on Tap is kind of, if you're in the room hearing what two people who've done it before really think.
Bill, you don't have a podcast. Not yet.
No, I think they're licensed to get in trouble.
So let me start with you, though. We take a look at what happened on Thursday night. Didn't change anything. It's a little more substantive, 10 candidates instead of 20 over two nights.
Yeah, this one felt like it was more alive, more real, more substantive, of course. And I think the other piece of it was we saw some of the people who hadn't done very well in the other debates, you know, pop up Beto came back to life, and he's obviously talking about what happened in El Paso very eloquently and emotionally. I thought Klobuchar, Booker, and Buttigieg all had very good nights. We hadn't seen that before. Mike calls them the understudies, did really well. I think that's really true.
But we also see a Democratic Party that has shifted to the left in a way that we hadn't seen in ever.
Yeah.
The fact is that the kind of statements that were made Thursday night, you never would have seen just the last cycle. For example, confiscation, maybe AR-15s, but the confiscation of weapons coming out of Beto O'Rourke.
There are a couple of candidates that were taking real flyers, at least against the old rules of what you can do in politics in a general election. We might be in a different era on guns, but it's issues like background checks, maybe high-capacity magazine bans that have some support, but mandatory confiscation. Look, I've worked Michigan and Wisconsin politics, done a bunch of governor races in both places. You walk through a UAW plant outside of Detroit, you're going to see bumper stickers that say UAW. You're going to see NRA. You know, people talk about the gun lobby like it's all Smith and Wesson putting money around Capitol Hill. It's not. It's highly organized gun single-issue voters that have the problem and the power. And that are the problem, I would say, for changing gun legislation. But they have the power, and a lot of them are in those industrial blue-collar states. So background checks, everybody's for it. But confiscating, that's a whole different battle.
Everybody's not for background checks, starting with the Republicans in Congress, who are all against it, including Mitch McConnell, who inexplicably continues to not bring this up for a vote. So the idea that everybody's for background checks, as Mike says, that ain't
well,
so.
Voters, right. There's research to say that voters, yes.
Republicans in Congress, no.
The attack that Julian Castro made against the former vice president, that was quite astounding, I thought, when I saw that, and I'm just wondering.
How about this? It was really stupid. The one thing we're not going to have any trouble in this campaign is forgetting that Julian Castro ever ran for president of the United States. This is the second time he's done it. He did an attack on Beto that was a very false at the beginning of these debates, and now he did it with the vice president. I mean, he just should get over himself.
You know,
how that helps him, I have no
idea. But does it help another candidate? Candidate A attacks candidate B, candidate C wins.
Well, that's the question. I was laughing because I've been in this game like Carrick has here a long time. I've never seen a candidate not only blow up his own dormant presidential campaign, but blow up his more promising vice presidential campaign all in the same 20 seconds. Joe Biden may not be the nominee. He's a vulnerable front runner, but he is popular in the party. And to essentially call him senile on television was a stupid move for Castro. The question is, will that subtext of is Biden super sharp or not at his age start to help other candidates? And we'll see. I will say this. Castro is now has created a growing fan club in the basement of the Republican National Committee. Because in the first debate, by attacking Beto, he got a lot of these candidates to raise their hands about decriminalizing border crossings. They fell off their chairs at the RNC. They couldn't believe how lucky that was. Then he overtly accused the vice president of not being mentally particularly sharp. again, did nothing for Castro, but more ammo is a Trumpian kind of attack. So in the long run, that discussion, I thought Biden handled it well, but it's out there. So Castro may be gone, but that issue is going to increase expectations on Joe to go out and be sharp and do better. And he can be. The first half of the debate, I thought he was doing great.
I thought that for Vice President Biden, the first part of the debate when they talked about Medicare for All, and he got into the weeds about what it actually does, I think he scored a lot of political points at the expense of Senator Sanders, of course, and Elizabeth Warren. Bernie is at least honest. He's telling us how he's going to pay for it, and we're going to pay a $1 billion for it. She did not look sure-footed on that because she doesn't want to talk about the costs.
First debate, she didn't dominate. So for the candidate who's been clearly in ascension more than anybody else, didn't hurt her, but no forward motion, which is a change. She's done very well in the past debate.
Mike Murphy, Bill Carrick, will have more when we return.